Pretty good timing.
For sure.
Jordan.
Nice to meet you.
Pete likes to admire his bicep from all angles. You see me after.
What did you put on?
You don't want to stand up.
It's a pair of used boxer shorts.
I didn't want to be an electrician, actually. Never wanted to be an electrician.
Well, basically,
cut this out.
Around 54% of tradespeople have had their tools stolen at some point.
Got some massive Marshall amps in there.
Fridge.
Ow. Why did I not notice that so when you opened it earlier?
I'm like a bit of like 80s.
That is
80s
brilliant.
You're already on here. Classic.
We don't see ourselves the whole time.
Oh, we've got a sticker on. Got a sticker on there.
Have you got any stickers?
I didn't bring. I didn't bring.
Really?
You have to send one in. And
when it's black, it's weird.
No. In other words,
it with the screen, so when it's not, it feels weird.
Pete likes to admire his bicep from all angles. You see me after.
I don't look good.
You can try.
Can we get the official?
Yes, okay. Pete, I'm not moving sides tonight. You're just going to have to show you where the bicep off.
But we do the same every... And plus, I need to change this T-shirt. Because it's a fucking woman's.
You can't tell, though.
You can't want to stand up.
Well, you're not standing up, are you? Well, stand behind here.
He literally needs to
hide. There's a thing about... He likes his photo taken from that side, but sits on this side.
Such it's a continuity.
Stand up.
We've always done it like that, though.
Oh, why have you stuck? Look at the size of him! I'm literally slightly taller than you,
so.
When he's in there. Oh, next to the big guy.
He looks like a fucking toddler.
Put the blonde midget on the end.
I can bend my knees if you want.
And also, no bashing on the table because Pete will look at you as if you've just farted in his face, and also no bending too far back from the mic or left and right because you won't.
I guarantee you both.
We try not to swear because we're a PG channel.
I've watched the show. I actually looked to buy massive foam helmets so that if I did bang the table,
everyone does it though. Everyone bangs the table. It's just a thing you do when you're talking.
You bang the table.
So, only once when I said
that was probably like, do you ever shut up? So Glenn gave me the glare the other day. He was sat over there as if to say, oh, you've bashed the table. And the very next sentence, he was like, bang. Yeah. I was like, it's easier said than done, Glenn. Let's get these bad boys on. Do you know anybody, Pete, from the plumbing world called Pablo Plumcabar?
No. But it sounds like someone I'd want to know.
The council plumber, his name is.
Awesome.
He's the guy who pulls the fuses us, usually.
I'll give you that one, and then I'll... Literally, Pablo Plumcabar, council plumber.
Yeah.
So, just before we start then, Pete, what do you think it is? The camera's running now, Jack. Yeah. What do you think it is?
I will guess it's a pair of used boxer shorts.
No. We know that you've been sent male nudes before.
Is that true?
In your DMs.
I had heard rumors.
But it's not that. And he's requested that you wear it on the show.
Big owl.
Wales, giant flag.
Awesome.
So, Pablo.
Yeah, cool stickers.
Is that a Welsh flag?
It's like a wolf.
I feel like I need to take this off because
he didn't send me any.
I'm the only one
what
that's
did
not
say?
Wearing a t-shirt.
Kimru. Oh, what did they say?
Sonny Kilikaragodigodigodigod.
Kumri. Dusky Kumraig. My mum lives in Wales, I think. Something like that.
I'll tell you what I'll do for you, Pablo.
Dusky Shara Kumraig.
I'm running the Worcester Half Marathon on the 22nd of May.
Are you going to get a Welsh dragon tattoo across your chest, Pete?
I'll cross the line like that for you, bro.
It's basically because Pete has a thing where whenever we go to Wales, we talk about Wales, he just doesn't know where anywhere is or can't say the names correctly.
If you pronounce everything with quite a lot of phlegm, it usually works quite well.
Come on,
so where we are in Redditch. Let me just read you a couple of place names.
Glenberis.
Local to Redditch.
Yeah.
Here we go.
Oh, here we go. Licky, right. Licky End was the one that tickled you.
Yeah, I found a really good one. So you got Upper Bentley. That sounds a bit...
Yeah.
Where's Licky End?
I live near Licky.
You near Licky? You live near Licky End?
He lives on the Licky Hills.
There was quite a few...
We've got Trumpington where we live. That's quite a good one.
There was a really good one. Why can't I...
Hanbury.
That Hanbury,
was
that was
that
it.
Was the one that tickled you, wasn't it?
Go home and have a Hanbury shank.
My grandparents live in Upper Ramsbottom. That's quite a good one. Yeah.
What about you, Steve? Any good?
Alex, have you ever been Upper Ramsbottom?
No, but I did live in Witchbold, which tickled you as well, didn't it?
Witchbold.
Where was the other one?
There's also a village called Ugly near where I live. They've got the Ugly Women's Institute. That's quite a good one.
Charlotte, have you ever been to Crab's Cross?
She actually does.
Oh God!
You couldn't have made that up.
There's some funny places around here. Roddington.
Pete, unfortunately, people want to get home tonight. I could do this all
you can
night.
Stay for an hour afterwards. Just read some place names.
We'll lock you in here, and you can get Google Maps up for an hour. Tickle yourself.
That's funny.
So, get the Welsh flag out, Pete. No, come on. Wrap it round you, mate.
No, come on.
So, I've started the last two, so you're up tonight. Let's hear it. Do you want me to start?
No, I'll do it.
Yeah. Yep. We have this argument every time as well.
Who's going to start?
Yeah. Thanks, Pablo.
Is it a short straw, then?
What's this for?
Well, there's only two of us. It's 50-50, isn't it? Oh, that's for me.
Which camera shall I look at?
Oh, you just...
Look at you.
Yeah, three cameras.
To my eyes. Around the eyes or directly into
the
eyes? Welcome Ready. Back to the Trade Legends Podcast, episode 19.
18.
18, one out.
Oh, God. Have we ever got this right?
And welcome to the excellent Artisan Electrics, Jordan, and we've got Steve from Armed. So we're going to be chatting... What?
Armed.
That's what it is.
I'm glad I wore it.
You'd have no idea otherwise.
Because I almost said ARMD, but it's armed.
Armed. So, yeah, so who do you want to start with then tonight?
Well, we'll start with Jordan, because I think you're going to have a lot to say about... Well, I hope you've got a lot to say, and it's going to be an interesting story about how you've, grown your YouTube channel into something incredible, really.
It's a bit of a monster now. So, I mean, other people will be looking and thinking, yeah, there's bigger accounts out there, but in trade terms, especially in the UK, me and you, and I'm sure loads of other people watching this have seen the progression and how the channel's changed and how the team's grown and stuff like that. So we always get guests to sort of take us back to how you came into the trade and how you came to be, and then take us on that journey from there to sort of current day now. So I'll leave it over to you. Just give us a bit of a backstory for everybody that's listening and watching.
Yeah, so just a little old electrician, really.
Yeah.
Did my thing, did my apprenticeship, the very traditional kind of route with my dad, because he was an electrician. I didn't want to be an electrician, actually. Never wanted to be an electrician. I thought that it was a bit, old trades, a bit of a dumb job, I wanted to do something a bit more clever, like computers and stuff.
Was that something that you've... Because we talk about this a lot on here, is... at school, was it something that, the way that school sort of portrayed it to you, or was that just...
Yeah, definitely, because it was when I was at school anyway, it was all about, you've got to go to university to get a good job, that's the only way, you've got to go, you leave school, you go to sixth form, then you go to university. So when you're 16, you don't know what you want to do with your life. Mm. I didn't. So I was like, okay, I'll just go to sixth form then. So I did that. Studied business and archaeology for a year, like you do, because you just...
Any good archaeology? Because I've always wondered, one of them degrees that people go and do, and you're like, sounds pretty good.
I thought it would be great, I was going to be the next Indiana Jones, and I was really looking forward to digging up treasure and stuff. Yeah. And then I realised that it's really, really boring. And in the second year, you get to go to Egypt for a field trip. And I was kind of hoping for that. But I gave up after a year. It was just too boring. Business was good, to be fair. It taught me a lot of stuff, which I use now running a business. Mm. But ultimately, after a year at sixth form, I was just like, what am I doing? And I saw my dad. He had a great skill that he'd always been busy. He'd always had plenty of work. He'd earned good money. been able to support us as a family. And so I kind of went back to him and ate humble pie and said, Dad, will you give me an apprenticeship?
Listening to that, so was it a bit of, school didn't really encourage trades and gave it that sort of stigma, but also was it, you know, when you're young, you sort of, you've got that rebel side of you and it's like, I don't want to do what you're telling me to do. Was it part of that, was that your dad particularly maybe wanted you to do it, but you were just, no, I'm not listening to you. Did that play a bit of a part with it as well?
I mean, he never really pressured me to be an electrician. Like, I used to go and work with him sometimes and I had a good time and everything. It was nice. But, you know, you get people asking you all the time, oh, you're going to be an electrician like your dad. And I'd just...
Cringe.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It was that, really. So it was never expected for me to follow in his footsteps, even though actually it was kind of a family tradition in a way, because my granddad's an electrician as well, and his dad was like worked in the mines, doing cables in the mines and stuff, so it goes back a long way. But I didn't really want to follow that tradition until I kind of grew up and realized that actually he was onto a really good thing. So yeah, did my apprenticeship with him, that was awesome, got qualified, and then unfortunately he got really ill and died of pancreatic cancer. It was like boom, and he was gone. And I obviously, that was like,
blew your world apart.
Yeah, it just totally blows your world apart. And
how old are you at this point?
So I was 21.
Yeah.
Just got qualified as an electrician, just done my AM2 and passed my exams and stuff like that. And
did your dad get to see that?
I think he saw me qualified, and then it was like, okay, you're taking over the family business now, you know, because there was no choice. Was that
your original plan? Were you working with your dad when you did your apprenticeship?
Yeah.
How did you get on with your dad? Because I did mine with my dad, and I worked with Kev because I couldn't work with my dad because we just argue about everything. Yeah. And that was more me being childish and he tells me something to do and I don't want to do it because it's my dad. If it was, I was working for a company and my boss told me to do something, obviously I'd do it.
Yeah.
So did you have that similar dynamic with your dad?
Sometimes, yeah. I mean, there's always that to a certain aspect, but he was just brilliant. He was like so chilled that he was very patient. You know, it's really hard training an apprentice, isn't it? Because it's like frustrating. You're watching them and you're going like, I could do this 10 times faster.
Yeah.
And he was so patient and he just taught me, you know, methodically how he would do things. So as in terms of like, how good can you have an apprenticeship? It was sort of like the gold standard, really.
Because that's the worst thing that guys that don't work for family experience when they're apprentices. They're working with someone who wants to get the job done and go home.
Yeah.
So because they're so much slower, they don't get the chance to do the work. So I was lucky, you were lucky that we actually had someone who was patient and let us work from a pretty early stage in your apprenticeship. But it's tough for...
I mean, one thing I want to sort of draw from there was, do you think the way that your dad was with you, because I look at sort of the little group of people that you've got working for you now, do you think that's enabled you? Because you seem to be adding people all the time, bringing on apprentices. Do you think that's helped you in that scenario, learning sort of from him and how calm he was? Because, you know, I have it when I bring staff in here, is you're that busy and... You know, especially when you're growing, you feel like there's not enough hours in the day anyway, and then you feel like you've always got to double over on stuff. You know, do you think, obviously, watching how he was with you, you've transferred some of that into, you know, some of the members of staff that you've got now?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, he always took pride in his work, and that sort of rubbed off on me. And I think it is a little bit different. Like Pete was saying, when you're sort of employed and you just want to get, you know, you just do your hours and get home, it's different when you're a business owner and it's your baby. You do naturally take a bit more pride in what you do, and that was how he was, and so that obviously rubbed off on me.
So I'll keep it short and I'll keep it sweet. As you can see, I've got one of these lovely Bisley Workwear t-shirts on here. They're our good friends, our main headline sponsor, and just to show some appreciation for the real good quality workwear that these guys do, they've given us a 15% off discount code. So if you click here, it'll take you straight through. So if you're interested in some decent workwear gear, Bisley's got you covered. I mean, how you know, because for people listening, every single story is completely different, but you're 21 now, obviously, you know, that's just happened in your life, which is a big thing for anybody. But now you're running a business at 21. Yeah. I mean, the thought of doing that potentially for myself scares the life out of me, because you know, you're still trying to find your way. You've only just qualified. So ideally, you still need to learn and get that experience. Like, tell us about that part now then. So from 21, you're suddenly running a business, like, and maybe the difference between where you were at 21 and any sort of tips you can give to somebody that might be in a similar situation that's been thrust into something, and what you know now as well.
Yeah, I mean, it was mad when I look back, because like the last couple of weeks of my dad's life, he was like sitting me down, like, this is how you do invoices and this is how you do quotes and stuff like that, just trying, because that part he'd never really trained me on, because he didn't need to. It was like how to do the job, but not how to do the business side of things. So I was really thrust into the deep end when it came to the business, and he did as best he could in a few weeks, but it wasn't enough to really teach you how to run a business back to front. So I really had to learn as I went along. And of course, I made loads of stupid mistakes, as you do when you're 21, like a bit naive, working for the wrong people sometimes, you know, got stung a few times, non-paying customers and things like that.
Yeah.
And I sort of learned the hard way quite quickly. It was quite a steep learning curve. But yeah, learn a few tough lessons. So I'd say that for anyone who is like young and starting their own business, if you can get like a mentor or somebody who's done it already, who you can work with and they can coach you a bit, that's a massive help, because there's just so many lessons that now I look back on and think, that's so obvious. Why did I not realise that? Mm. But unless you've been through it yourself, you don't necessarily know.
I mean, one thing that I've noticed with you, you do some do you do courses for people? Was that something that I saw? I mean, you know, you always go to colleges because you like to talk to the next generation. Is that something in the future then for you that you feel like all those little bits where you think, oh, what was I doing? You know, there needs, I feel that there needs to be more people that are giving that advice out. You know, is that something that you'd consider in the future? Obviously, like, the more business side of things to help people, actually doing some sort of like coaching on that sort of side for people. Is that something you consider?
Yeah, I mean, I've created a whole course, an electrician's business course, it's called, where I've literally done like a brain dump of my whole journey of starting and running a business from start to finish. Because there were so many people reaching out to me on social media going, oh, like, I want to start up on my own, but I don't know how to get started. And I was trying to help as many people as I could, just like with the DMs and things, but it's impossible to reply to everyone. So I thought, let me just do a video course, you know, and just share everything that I've learned up to this date, and hopefully it will help a few people. And it's been brilliant, actually. Last weekend I met one of my students, and he's just starting his business, and just to see that, you know, how much he'd benefited up to this point was really it was great. It's a really feel good moment for me, just being able to sort of have a chat to him and about his sort of journey up to date.
I mean, what's one bit of advice that you'd give to somebody that's starting now? You know, would you say to your younger self, just ask more questions? What one bit of advice would you say to somebody now that's 21, same situation?
I would say, if you're starting your own business, you need to plan. Like, don't just jump into it, but make a plan. Because so many people, like, for example, on pricing, this is a classic one that I get asked so much. It's like, how do I decide how much to charge? And a lot of people just go like, oh, I want to earn, you know, £30 an hour or whatever, so I'll charge customers £30 an hour. And they've not thought about all the overheads and other things that they need to factor into their prices. So it's like just sitting down, planning, thinking ahead, and plan with the end in mind. So what business do you want to end up with? That's one of the biggest pieces of advice I would give to people. Just a little bit, invest a bit of time to plan ahead rather than just sort of jumping straight in.
Okay. So you're 21. You've been running the business. Like, where do you then start your social media journey? When does that begin?
So quite a long time later, really. I mean, I've always been quite tech savvy, so I've always done social media. But for that business, it was a family business. I ran it for a few years fairly successfully, sold that business, went abroad and did volunteer work for a few years. And then I came back in 2016 and started Artisan with all the lessons that I'd learned from the previous business, but with like a blank canvas, essentially. So it was quite nice because it was like a fresh start. I could start a business without the baggage of the previous business, because old businesses do tend to have a certain amount of baggage, but with all the ideas and the inspiration that I'd taken from the learning that I'd done and the volunteer work that I'd done. And 2016. So I just did all the usual stuff, you know, start a YouTube page, start an Instagram page, Twitter, all that, just to put your flag in the ground and claim your name on social media.
Yeah.
And then I just posted a few videos here and there, nothing really special. I think my first video was just a light fitting that was full of water, and I
Watch it now? Because occasionally I look
every
back
so often.
Occasionally I look back over social media and I'll go, God, some of the stuff I did. So cringy, or my
some
hair.
Of the haircuts.
Oh, yeah.
I know, yeah, the haircuts were terrible, and you can't change them, can you?
The introductions for me, and like the classic mistake of like looking at yourself on the phone instead of looking at the camera, so your eyes are like slightly off. All those
my favourite, absolute favourite one is Instagram Lives.
Yeah.
And I did it when I first started. You wait for people to join. So when someone watches back later, you're just sat there thinking, I'm just waiting for a few people to join. Whereas they just want to see you talk about what you want to talk about. That's
we had an Instagram Live where I was waiting for you. You needed to update your phone. You didn't come on. And then I poured beer all over my iPad and killed the iPad. I was like, oh, no. That was an embarrassing one as well. So as you know, myself and Pete, we always want to try and give back to the people that watch and listen to the show. So we've done you an absolute solid. We've got loads of discounts from top name brands all across the internet. So if you want to save some money on tools, software, tool bags, accessories, then go and check out our discount page, which is just located here. Hopefully there's a saving on there for you, and that's a little bit of a thank you from myself and Pete for supporting the channel. But yeah, so you've come back, you've started your own business. Yeah. I mean, obviously when you go and do volunteer work and you have some time away from the trade, was it always in the back of your mind that you were going to come back and go into the trade, or was it just you felt like that was the right time to come back?
Yeah, it was sort of part of necessity and part of it was the right time. So, it was the next step for me, basically. Mm. And then we were just like, okay, let's start afresh. Mm. So the YouTube thing was never intentional, though. Like, I don't know if it was for you, but for me, like, I posted a video of an immersion, you know, the cutout, thermal cutouts on the immersion heater.
Yeah.
This is one of my first videos that ever kind of blew up, was a little vertical video that I filmed on my phone of how to reset the thermal cutout in an immersion heater.
Yeah.
Because I got so many people contacting me like, oh, my immersion heater stopped working. And I'd go out and I'd just press the button and then be like, that's 100 quid, please. You know? And I thought I could probably do a little video to show people how to do it themselves, and it would, you know, save them a bit of money, and it'd help a few people. Shooting myself in the foot a little bit, but I guess that's a little bit like what we do on social media, and then it all comes back to us in the end. But that video got like over 100,000 views, and I was all these comments, oh, that's really helpful, thank you. And I started to realize the power of social media in actually just sharing little tips and things with people that can really help them.
Yeah.
And then also I got some other videos where it was like electricians were commenting like, oh, I like the way you do that, or oh, I would do that differently. And all that engagement and that learning from the comments.
Here's a question for you then. How do you deal with the, you should do that differently, or why didn't you do that, or you've done that wrong? Do you engage in conversation, or does it wind you up, and do you sort of fall for the bait?
I think the more you grow, the more likely you are to get that type of negativity, I think.
I don't know, because I've seen people put their first ever post on and get absolutely destroyed, even if they're an apprentice and their work's not going to be the best. It's harsh out there.
You've got to have thick skin, for sure, because there's keyboard warriors and haters who are just going to say stuff that's not constructive and it's just nasty.
Yeah.
But I've always had fairly thick skin anyway, so I've managed to kind of not let that get to me. But the interesting thing is that there are a lot of constructive comments, or comments of just like, oh, you know, you've done it that way, but I would have done it this way. And you learn, I've learned so much from the comments, actually. And we get picked up on our mistakes as well, because we do make mistakes sometimes.
Oh, yeah, everyone does, yeah.
And people, like, pick you up and you're like, oh, my goodness, I didn't realise. Yeah. And we've had one recently. Like, I'll tell you about it. It's been a bit of a disaster, but basically one of the guys who was chasing in a cable to put a cable in a wall, and he chopped out a load of wood in this wall. And it's like a wooden timber framed house.
Yeah.
And we did, you know, didn't think about it, just chopped out this wood to get the cable down, put the plasterboard back, you know, jobs are good and nice and neat. Nobody can see any cables. Fantastic, you know. And then all the video went out and all the comments started pouring in. Oh my goodness, that wood is structural. You've damaged the structural integrity of the house. You've cut the vapor barrier of the house and all this stuff. And I was just thinking, it's just the haters, you know. And more of these comments were coming in. I was like, well, maybe this is actually a thing.
Yeah.
So I had to go round there and get a structural engineer to look at it.
Yeah.
And it turned out that the wood was okay. I mean, it was the damage that we'd done to it wasn't so bad that we needed to fix it. But we did need to repair the vapor barrier because we had cut that, which was a bit naughty. And it was like, yeah, so I got it all fixed and stuff. Cost me a couple of grand to fix it all.
But it's good because you're putting content out there to pass on your knowledge, and the people that are watching it, commenting, are also giving you knowledge. I love it, especially when someone tells me something I didn't know.
Yeah.
The downside is the people that are constantly trying to get one up on you and
Twitter
just picking at everything you do.
Can you Twitter just watch is that?
Worst, isn't it? I'm hoping it's going to get can. Better.
Twitter's the worst, right? So if you put a job on Twitter and there's something, it might be the best job you've ever done, but if there's a tiny thing wrong, someone will pick up on it and they won't say nice job, but they'll just say that's wrong. And the downfall of many people on Twitter is they will bite and they will argue and then they'll comment and then the other person will comment and they'll get into an argument and it'll be
snowball.
If you see that comment and ignore it, nobody else sees it. It disappears in on the timeline of Twitter. But some people can't ignore a comment like that.
Yeah.
So I'm quite chill and I never really rise. Sometimes I'll make a joke out of a troll comment and I'll, you know, be a bit mischievous. Mm.
Does that ever work out though, or end up just wasting?
No, like one guy said to me, I did a tool bag review and he just like, I put my tools in a bucket. I said, well, if you turned up at my house, unless you were cleaning the windows, then you won't get the job, kind of thing. You just have a joke. What, the one which will relate to you, I did a van tour and obviously I'm showing my kit inside my van. This is before I got into the sort of whole van security stuff. And this guy put, where'd you park it at night? Meaning, you've just shown me inside your van, I'm going to come rob it. I just put on your mum's drive. Which sort of kills it.
Stops that one.
Do you get much of it, or have you got a generally nice community?
Yeah, I mean, most people are nice. There's always 1% of haters, but when, you know, you've got hundreds of thousands of people watching your videos, 1% is quite a lot of people. So you've just got to learn to kind of like not let it get to you. But what we can do is learn a lot from the positive comments. And it's difficult because you get loads of positive comments and sometimes you can be so focused on the one or two negative ones that they let you get you down. But I even, for a while, I actually made a habit of screenshotting. Whenever I got someone send me like a really great Instagram DM or something saying, thanks so much for your videos, they've really helped me, I'd screenshot it because I wanted to kind of create a collection of all these positive comments that I could look back on if I ever did have one or two negative ones that got to me. And that's what you just got to focus on, is there's always going to be more positivity than negativity, hopefully.
Yeah.
And the constructive comments, you can learn from them. I mean, there's more than one way to skin a cat, as they say.
I mean, one question I was going to ask you is the name Artisan Electrics, obviously is French. You know, I think you've explained this before where the name came from, but for anybody listening or watching who doesn't know where the name came from, is there a little backstory behind the name Artisan Electrics?
Yeah, I mean, when you're starting a business, obviously you've got to come up with a name, and it's like what I was saying earlier about planning with the end in mind. I was thinking, okay, what customers do I want to attract with my business? So I want to attract customers who want a really good job done to a high standard. They're not so worried about, you know, penny pinching and getting the cheapest job. I want people who are looking for quality over price. What kind of people are they? They're the kind of people who go to the artisan bakery and pay more for a loaf of bread because it's good quality, or the artisan coffee shop, you know, to get that lovely thing on the top of the cappuccino. And so that was where it kind of came from. And it's really worked. Yeah. You know, we've got an amazing customer base that in general, we've got beautiful houses that we get to work in with lovely customers, don't have problems with people paying, because we've targeted the right kind of demographic.
Unless you chop the wrong wood down.
That customer's actually really nice. He was amazing about it.
Yeah, no, that's good. I mean, that's really interesting to hear, because I think, again, when you start a business, the one thing that you don't realise, I mean, I look for names like this one that Pete hates, Trade Legend, and you're always looking you think of a name and you go, oh, go on, domain name. And then you see it's taken, so you think, right, I need, I'll try another name. And you just keep coming up with names. And some of them, when you look back on a list, you just think, God, why was I going to call it, I don't know, like Shooter Commando or something like that. And you're just like, the, some of the names that you come up with, but that's, it's really interesting to hear how you talk about that name. I mean, one thing that I want to move on to as well, because there's a bit of banter between you and another electrician on YouTube and social media. What's the backstory with you and Mr. Bundy? And is there actually any sort of like little competition between you? Because I know you recently all did a video together, which was good to see, because that's one thing as well that I tend to find is that not a lot of people do like sort of, you know, little things, collaborations, yeah, that's the word. So what's the backstory with Bundy? Obviously, you've got more subscribers than Bundy. I'll just toss that one out there for Nick, if he's watching.
Yeah, I have now, but it wasn't always that way. You know, we've kind of come up together in YouTube, really, and that's the thing, that like we both started at a similar time, and it's been sort of neck and neck along the way, and sometimes he'd overtake me, and then I'd overtake him.
Yeah.
And so through all that, we kind of been in touch with each other, and then... you know, helped each other out, you know, had a few phone chats about things, you know, how to deal with certain things and challenges and whatever. But there's always been that little bit of banter as well, obviously, because it's kind of, it's healthy competition and and it's a bit of fun. But that was actually the first time that I got to meet him in person, and he came and we did a video together, and he worked with the guys and we stuffed our faces with Thai takeaway, and it was good.
I think that's one, you know, we always talk about it on here, one really good positive about social media is when you do meet like-minded people and then you can collaborate or you can learn off them. I think that's like a massive part of that. So when you talk about that sort of side with Nick, I think that's a great sort of incentive for anybody that's listening or watching on here to sort of start up their social media and then obviously like ask questions to sort of grow their business and stuff like that. So I think that's a good thing to come from that. You got any more questions for?
Well, just on the Nick thing, I don't, it's good that you you are friends and you can do stuff together, because what's the point of being against each other? You know, no, who's going to benefit? Nobody. People are going to invent beef when there is none. And when we do things like a tool theft campaign, you can help, Nick can help, I can help, and we can all work together.
Yeah.
Whereas when you've got people, I remember I did a van campaign, I think I've mentioned it before on the show, the first time I did a van tool theft campaign, a couple of guys that don't like me, because competition, you know, the internet's big enough for everyone. If I've got a YouTube channel and 10 other people have got a plumbing YouTube channel, so what? The people who are watching it benefit, they get all these different YouTube channels to learn from. But they just wanted to do everything they could so that the van tool theft campaign didn't succeed. You know, they're helping no one apart from their own egos. So it's nice that you can do that together and you can, you know, help each other out and everyone benefits.
Yeah, I mean, you've helped me over the years a few times. Like, I've watched your video for ages, actually. Like, probably even before. You've been doing YouTube longer than I have, haven't you?
I started YouTube just doing tool reviews. I did the day in the life thing.
You stopped for a long time though, you did, didn't you?
Yeah.
How long are you talking about? Because that's the
I
bit
will
that,
tell you.
The speed at which you...
Well, yours is 2016, did you say?
Yeah, but I didn't really start seriously until 2018, probably.
So like four years is...
Yeah. It's a
short period of time, really.
130,000 subscribers in 4 years.
A heck of a lot of hard graft.
My first video was a Vito Pro Pack tech.
Just need to be a Vito.
Tech LC review 5 years ago.
There you go. Yeah. So I'm.
Is that a back of the bench?
I probably watched some of your first videos, and probably subconsciously, your videos inspired me to do what I'm doing.
Awesome.
You know, because I just thought.
Electric.
Like, even though, like electrician and plumbers, there's always that thing, isn't it? Oh, we don't like each other or whatever. But I found it fascinating. And I just thought it was really cool that you could actually do YouTube about, you know, doing plumbing or.
What trade
whatever.
Would you be if you weren't an electrician then?
Carpenter.
Would you?
I think, yeah. I mean, I have thought, I do, like, when I see Pete's work, I'm like, wow, pipes, they look, I've never seen pipes that look so nice.
It's weird though, because like
the shiny copper.
I'd also, not a carpenter, maybe a joiner, I'd like to have like a workshop where I could fill it with all my favourite things and be in there working, make stuff.
Yeah.
So probably join a bit.
Yeah, yeah, it's satisfying. Like working with something natural like wood is just, there's something about it, isn't it? Yeah. Like
I just really
I do that
lathe.
As a hobby on the weekends. Like I make an oak table or something.
Yeah. Have you got a lathe?
No.
I watch these lathe videos online all the time. They're just incredible. Yeah. Unless you catch your jumper in it sucks you in. But yeah, yeah, something so like some, that, I'd be similar.
Yeah, when you watch people doing woodworking or even metal fabricating, like welding and stuff like that, some of the stuff like sculpting that people come up with just from that, it's like unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable.
It's incredible stuff they do, but it takes a lot of time and they don't get paid for, you know, when you look at it and think that's amazing, they don't get anywhere near as what you think it would be worth in your head when you're watching it.
Mm.
Yeah. But it must be, the job satisfaction must be unreal.
Yeah.
So
I mean, going back to the social media though, like I remember you messaging me a few times on Twitter as well because I had like little plumbing questions about like heating systems and
stuff.
We're
just trying to be helpful.
And it's just helping each other out. Yeah. And that's a great thing. Now we have this whole community. Mm. When I did my apprenticeship, it was me and my dad and I learned from him and that was it. Now you've got a whole, you know, I can learn from the best in the trades all over social media. Mm. And that's amazing. Like for our apprentice Ruben now, you know, he's learning from us and our team, but he's also able to learn from other trades on social platforms. Yeah. That is just so powerful.
So, ladies and gents, tradesmen and women, I am trying to help you organize yourself. So we have teamed up with Tradeify, which is a software brand that if you are struggling to get organized, to look after your customers and to get everything ready for the jobs that you are going to need, then Tradeify is an all-in-one solution. So we've teamed up with those guys. If you click this little link just up here, you get 50% off your first 3 month subscription and you also can have a 14-day free trial. Let's jump over now to you. Steve, and armed. So, you know, give us a bit of your backstory, personal backstory, and then lead us how you became involved with Armed as a company and what Armed does as well for everybody listening and watching.
Okay, how long we got?
as long as you need. I mean, obviously we've talked about tool theft, so that's probably going to be
a bit of a clue.
Yeah, you know, a big part of what you'll talk about.
I'm not a thief, by the way. Make that clear. Thank you for having us on, by the way.
Yeah, no worries.
I wonder when you actually become a legend. Do you just qualify as a legend?
This is the issue what I have with the name, because to be a legend, you've got to do something incredible. Legendary, you've got to be a war hero or like
I thought you just had
Stanley
to
Matthews.
See, my thing with the word legend was I always wanted something that was simple for people to remember, and people are legends in their own right. Everybody that does a trade does a really useful job that sometimes they don't get the recognition for. You know, like you talk about, well, without a plumber, you don't get hot water, you don't get sanitation, you don't get all those types of things. Like, that's overlooked.
Mm.
You know, so everybody that is in a trade, you know, it's about trying to elevate people to say, well, actually, you are in a decent job and you are doing a... Do you know what I mean? You know, why should somebody who's a lawyer or a solicitor or a doctor take all the glory? Don't get me wrong, you're saving a life, but at the same time, you know, if you guys and girls who are listening and watching aren't doing these jobs, the whole of society sort of stops, if that makes any sense. Sorry, that's a little rant from me, but
that was deep.
It's not a rant. I wanted to say something, but I'm going to keep it PG.
Well, basically,
cut this out.
No, my thing is I am useless with any of that sort of stuff. And anything where I, in my head, like I could do it, I think anybody could do it, but in my head I look at stuff and I think, do you know what, actually, in the grand scheme of things, what I do, you know, and I look at sort of what you guys are doing and I just think, you know, it's amazing. Like you say, when you look at somebody that's creating something out of wood and you just see how somebody's brain's working, you see how they've come up with something and the way they've done it, it fascinates me.
I think that creating the lights that you've created is pretty legendary, to be honest. Yeah. You have saved a lot of pain and small cupboards, lighting up small cupboards.
It is and it isn't. But I just feel like there's certain brands that want to do things. Obviously, you're going to talk about your brand, where I think actually is really going to help.
Mm.
So if it does come off, obviously, you are a legend because you're going to be solving a massive problem for everybody.
And I thought I just had to come on the show and I qualified. That was...
Wow, you know. But like I say, that name came from me thinking, well, actually, people don't get the recognition they deserve.
So, well, that's... So, I feel like a bit of an imposter syndrome. I don't know how to wire a plug, literally, that bad. I'd have to watch a
lot. Jordan will do it for 100 quid.
That's switch.
I don't know that anymore.
I'm 120 now because of cost increases. 120.
I'm not a tradesperson, not an insurance person. My background's actually design. So you're talking about brand, naming, artisan, so on. That was it. I could draw, often guests on your show, like they either want to follow somebody, I've watched a lot of them in the trade, or they kind of get a bit stuck at school and go and find something different. You know, I'm again, not quite the same, got on well at school, really good art department that helped sharpen that. And the short story is I started a design studio, age 23, and ran that for 18, 19 years, still on the back burner. And in doing that, design at its core for me and any good designer is problem solving. So you talk about carpenters and how you take a piece of wood and then you turn it into something else. You know, if that something else is a table or something functional, then there's all sorts of different levels of problem solving. And through the years of the design studio, we were many different things, from animation for TV and film and corporate stuff. And branding was always key throughout. So I kind of gravitated towards startups and working with startups, generally an individual, really interesting idea, often very ambitious, but didn't know how to present to the public and turn it into a brand or something digestible, look at target markets and so on. And I just loved working startups, became a mentor, got involved with all these different businesses. So it was only a matter of time before I worked, or an idea came up, I was like, okay, I'm going to go and start that, and I'm going to go and put a team together, and that's how Armed kind of came about in a roundabout way.
So just explain to everybody listening or watching what Armed is and what problem you're trying to solve, because I feel like every business should have in the back of their mind what they're trying to achieve. Like for me, it's I want to save somebody 5% extra time working so that they can make more money. And if I solve that problem for somebody, then I feel like I've achieved something. So just explain to everybody what your aim is and what the sort of business is doing.
Yeah, okay. So Armed is an anti-tool theft set of technology. We're coming at it from a commercial point of view. There's lots of amazing initiatives out there. You've done brilliant things, whether it's rallying van manufacturers or your petitions and things like that, and that all needs to happen. I think there is a bit of a movement swell, you know, building with that, but there's not that much out there that's commercial. So we've come at it from a commercial point of view, and the background. So Devin, our CEO, had an IoT company which was smarter alarms and cameras in homes. He sold that company in 2019. And there was a body of installers for that company, about 350, and they kept coming and saying, can we put your technology in our vans? Because our tools keep being, and we kept hearing this, tools are being nicked. When that company was sold, Duncan and Devin came to me and said, shall we put a piece of hardware together to put into trade vans, you know? And we started digging a bit deeper and interviewing tradespeople and trying to understand the problem. The original idea was a camera. Let's put a camera in there. So you can see it from your phone and all of that. And realised really quickly that this was a massive problem. This wasn't just a handful of people. This was right. An epidemic. Can't really use that anymore. But
just one thing, because I know you've got some stats.
Yeah, I've got.
Give us some stats just to drill this home, because one thing that really frustrates me when we talk about tool and van theft, and there is a petition, is trying to get people to sign it. Give some stats on like how bad the problem is for anybody listening or watching.
Yeah, so there's lots of different stats banded around, and we did our own research, but the main ones is in the UK, a van is broken into every 23 minutes. That's one that probably most people have heard. And think about it. Think about that in the context of any other business. It's insane, the fact that it's that easy. That such sitting ducks is a phrase that keeps coming up, sitting ducks. And then our own research, we had over 54%, or around 54% of tradespeople have had their tools stolen at some point. You know, it's a story, and if you haven't, often they know people that have. And this is often more than once, two, three times. And then 44% of those don't have any insurance, which is confusing. Yeah. It's not that expensive to get insured and protect your tools. There's a lot of hate towards insurance, but you know, those are interesting stats. And on top of that, we've got, you know, one came out the other day, over 100 million plus worth of stolen tools in the past 2 years. Big money. 2019-21, London alone had over 28,000 tool thefts.
What, in 1 year?
It's about 18 months.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
You know, across sort of, it's a section of pre-COVID and then during COVID, because we were sort of watching to see if it got worse during COVID.
Yeah. Is that reported to the police, how many?
Exactly.
Yeah, so there's probably more.
And we speak to tradespeople all the time, and often it's like, oh, it was one tool, or I haven't got insurance. So that's only the reported, that information's from the Met Office.
Wow.
So it's an epidemic.
Mm-hmm. So what's the solution then? Because you've talked me through it. You've got, you know, some new technology that's coming.
Yep.
And hopefully you're going to aim to not completely solve it, but obviously be able to make things easier for people that do suffer.
Yeah, we're coming from the standpoint of, you know, we don't really think we're going to stop tool theft anytime soon. So what can we do to empower tradespeople to kind of better protect themselves? That's where we're coming at from it. We started with the alarm, and actually that's going to be the last thing. Hopefully towards the end of the year. And identified, really, the main problem is getting back to work once your tools have been stolen. You know, that seemed like the main problem. And it became, talking from a problem-solving point of view, became really interesting. You know, how do we get people back to work? We looked at tool hire, having tools, that big bank of tools that people could borrow if they can prove they've been stolen. We looked at insurance, we looked at different things. And the whole thing now centers around a tool inventory app that you can use on your desktop, online, download it or mobile, and you just can log your tools. It's three steps. Take a photo, put your serial number in. If you've got the receipt, take the receipt. If you haven't got the receipt, take a selfie of you with the tool, which is much easier to do before it's stolen. And with that, it's about getting organized. It's relatively straightforward. It is, you know, possibly an hour or two's work to kind of get that inventory in place.
And does that include everything? Hand tools?
So hand tools, you could
power tools.
Take a picture of the tool bag and estimate the value.
I think you mentioned something similar before, didn't you, saying that there should be a thing where you can just take a picture of your tools and make it simpler for...
Yeah, because most guys will clean their van out at the weekend. If they had a busy week, the van's like a bomb site, and they'll clean it out. And at that stage, you could be lining your kit up, take a photo, and then once it's done, all you've got to do is, when you get some new kit, add it to what you've already done. So it's only one time that you're going to spend a little bit of time setting it up. Excuse me. Most people say about things like this, though, what about, you know, I still use some of my granddad's gear. You might still have some of your dad's tools. How do I go about the receipt? But like you said, it's a you can take a photo, the serial number side, because you don't want people, you're always going to get bad eggs, and they're going to, let's buy this really expensive tool. I'll put it on my app. You put it on your app.
Yeah.
If you've got the serial number and the selfie, then someone else can't claim for that serial number. So
we're making it harder.
Yeah. It does sound like a really good idea, and I think it's something that someone, you know, is going to have a lot of success with, because the number one thing you hear from people is, when they do claim, the insurance company tries to get out of paying out for the tools. Whereas if you've got this database of what you've got, what can be their reason for not paying out?
There's also sort of an education. So we sit right in the middle. So we've got insurance, which is another product that we have, which is a tools in transit policy, 24 hours in the van. It's very specific to, it's just a dedicated tool insurance. We don't do anything else. That's underpinned by Royal Sun Alliance. We effectively broker that, and we've brought that in just to have it as an offering, because it's an important part of the puzzle, but it's something that people love to hate, basically. Yeah. And one thing that we identified early on is with tool insurance, you'll have, I didn't get what it's worth. You know, if you've got very precious tools, take them in at night. If you've got things that you can't live without, just take a photo and get your receipt.
What guys have got to understand is even if they've got insurance, they've still got a lot of responsibility to look after their gear. They can't just think, oh, I'm insured, so it don't matter.
That's it. Mm-hmm.
You've still got to take some tools in. You've still got to make sure you're deadlocking it. You've got to make sure where you're parking it, it's well lit. You're reversing so your doors are protected.
And anything you can, we always say, just marking your tools. What you can afford, like put as much into protecting them as possible, because it is your livelihood. Those figures, think how many livelihoods are affected and stopped. And one thing that the app does, which is a conversation that's never really had until the claim side, is it calculates and gives you a rough estimated market value of your tools that's live. So if you put the information in, it tells you what an insurance company might value those tools at. So up front, you kind of know what you're carrying around and what it's worth and whether you need to get a different policy and so on. And then the third part is we launched a tool shop. So we stock 30,000 tool products. The original idea was, so when somebody had a claim, we could replace it. We wanted to be able to replace the next day. And then we soon found out it's actually much easier to talk about the latest Milwaukee or DeWalt, this and that, than it is to talk about insurance. So it's become, and where we're going, so we've only just started. We launched in September. We crowdfunded successfully in December, kind of started going out to the trades this year. So we're really early on. But the aim for us is to get a tool purchased, just buy it, and if it's stolen, it arrives the next day on your doorstep. That's sort of our main mission with it, and these are baby steps towards it.
Yeah.
And the alarm is being trialled this summer, prototype 4, and should hopefully come out towards the end of the year.
Mm. So, I mean, listening to that myself, obviously not being a tradesperson, so for anybody listening or watching, the vibe I've got is that you've noticed that there's a big issue with it, which, you know, is good that people are starting to acknowledge that there is an issue now, because people have been banging that drum for so many years. But you've got this app that somebody can go on, log all their tools, they can put all the serial numbers in. If one of them does get stolen, or a few of them get stolen, they can then be replaced within a 24-hour period via the insurance.
That's what we're going for, yeah. Yeah, we had our first claim last month, because we're selling insurance policy, we're selling tool, we're up and running. Yeah. The app is free, you can use that.
Yeah,
and it doesn't mean much to the trades, but for the insurance world, it was a big deal, because he filed. It's called FNL, loss when it's first lost. Mm. He had all his inventory in there, swiped left the missing tools, filed it one evening, and under 72 hours without any questions, it had been approved by our insurer. Normally that's 4 or 5 weeks.
Because one thing that a lot of tradespeople don't realise until the tools get stolen is then having to wait for approval from the insurance company. So even if you are lucky enough to have insurance, and then, you know, if you don't have tools, you can't work.
Yeah.
So that issue of like turning that round quicker, if you can solve that problem for people, I think is a massive thing for...
And doing the work of uploading your kit to the app in a peaceful time when you're just cleaning your van out, and then when the worst happens and you're at the highest level of stress because your van's been broken into and you can't work and you've got customers chasing you, you've got to organise all your diary, you don't want to then be looking for receipts and trying to do all that. It's already done and you've done it.
The other thing as well, which I find, well, I probably would, is I'd be buying tools, and if I'm logging them inside the app and you've had them for 3-4 years, you might actually, if you do get everything stolen out of the van, have forgotten that you've actually got certain things. Yeah. So it will re-jog you to go, hold on a minute, that's missing as well.
Yeah.
You know, so that idea of being able to see exactly what you've got, a live, updated, potential tool replacement value as well, I think that is like, you know, it's so important for people.
That's it. And the other part of the shop is that if you buy a tool from us, it's automatically put into the app, so it's all receipted and done, which is just removing some of that hassle. But I think the claim bit is really key. People kind of think it's not going to happen to them. So to be organised and have things there, what, you know, the insurance company will view every claim on its own merit, meaning they'll look into your, if there's a criminal history, if there's other bits and pieces. So we can't, unfortunately, guarantee turnaround time. But we worked out a system of what claim handlers want to see. And then we've given an app where people can just get ready, get prepared, get armed, get everything listed just in case. And, you know, with 50% suffering.
Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of like when rather than if it happens.
We had a look at it before the podcast, and the thing I liked about it was when you click on make a claim, it tells you what to do. So obviously the first thing is call the police, so you get a crime number, but then you can add video or photographic evidence of your van, you know, whether the locks are missing, whether they've just cut a hole in the roof. If so, there's a witness, you can get them to make a statement, you can log that all. So everything, your case, basically, you can put as much information as you want and then just send that off to your insurance company, and they've got everything they need. They've got an inventory, they've got pictures of what happened, times, witnesses, if there is any, and it's all there.
We've got it, it's six steps. And it'll tell you then, you know, if there's information missing from individual tools, you can go back in and add, you know, bits and pieces to those tools. But we've managed to get that into six steps.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't have to insure with us to use it. You can, you know, just log your tools and still have the benefit.
I mean, have you ever had your tools stolen?
Yeah.
How about you, Jordan?
I haven't, but I remember when my dad's van got broken into when I was a kid and all his Hilti gear got nicked. Mm. And that was like, that scarred me for life. I remember staying up at the window at night for like days afterwards, looking out to see if they were coming back. And it is, as a business owner, it is a thing that you have in the back of your mind. Like, it's only a matter of time before it happens.
Yeah.
It's not like I'm thinking, you know, it'll be fine. I know, especially now we've got more vans, like more guys, more vans, the chances are just going up. Yeah. And I was going to ask you about that, actually. Like, how does it work for companies like myself where we've got a few vans? Can you kind of do that for all of the vans?
You could. It depends on the tools, really. So you could have multiple policies if each van has its own set of tools. I don't know how you work it. Yeah. At the moment, we're kind of more the individuals, the sole trader.
There's something for you there.
Yeah, no, there's the enterprise version is
fleet
is on the horizon.
It's a difficult one though, because like a lot of our guys have got their own tools and the company tools mixed up.
So you want to, and we speak to people that in your situation that the subbies have had their tools stolen, and it then puts a delay on the job because they are halfway through something, and that knock-on effect is. So actually, we're encouraging people like yourself to get the subbies logging tools and insured in the right way to protect your business as much as their own.
Yeah, that's good.
And the standing by the window thing reminds me, some of our early research. This is one thing where it's in my mind made me think, well, there's a problem here and there's a business here. We did some, during COVID, some Zoom kind of market research with sort of 10, 15 different tradespeople. And they're telling stories about tool theft. And one guy said, I'm up at least two or three times a night checking the bedroom window for every noise that I hear. And I was kind of shocked by that, thinking, well, these guys are losing sleep. But the bit that shocked me the most is that everyone else on the Zoom call was nodding.
Yeah. It's a massive anxiety about it. I went through a stage of it where I would sometimes have to go outside and just look.
Double check.
And the first thing you think about when you wake up in the morning, I hope my van's okay. And we shouldn't have to live like that. Mm. Talking about the mental health side of it, it's a tough job. Being self-employed is a tough job at the best of times. You've got so many different things to think about, so many things to look after, customers chasing you, jobs don't go right, someone's not paid you. Going out and expecting to be able to go to work and earn money and do your job, and then finding out all your tools are gone or your van's been completely trashed or even gone, that one day it's going to tip someone over the edge. Mm. And it's a lot of guys, I see it when it happens and they'll say, that's it, I'm done.
I'm done, yeah.
Because the other thing that will happen is the van will be broken into and they'll get it sorted and they'll get the new kit. And the guy who's robbed it knows they're going to have to replace the kit and they'll target them again and get all their new kit.
You know, that's where the harsher punishments need to come in that bigger campaigning, the bigger problem there. But it's devastating. Well, I've so many of those stories, third time and out, done. I'm going to go and get a different job.
Yeah.
Every day we hear them. It's terrible.
So the app is live.
App is live. Shop is live.
Shop is live. When does the alarm?
Alarm, fingers crossed, hope. End of the year.
End of the year.
Yeah. And that also, it ties in with the app, you see. So you come to make a claim.
Yeah.
The alarm is it's a smart alarm. So why is it different? If the back of the van is broken into, it phones you. That's the main thing that it does. So it can contact you in different ways. That's what we're empowering tradespeople on that side. The insurance side, it logs where the cars are. So it knows higher risk zones. It knows how often you arm and disarm it. So from a risk mitigation point of view, and when you're making a claim, it can say, yeah, the alarm was triggered at 2 a.m. and you were parked here.
Mm.
So again, we're making that claim handler's journey a lot easier when they're saying yes or no or this much or that much.
That's
we're doing.
Do you think all these things that you're doing, so the stuff that you're talking about, like that actually speeds up the process as a claim because you're taking all the...
That's the idea.
Oh, well, you said you were here, but actually were you here?
Yeah.
Or, you know, hopefully it just speeds up that process for people.
And that's what you need at that time when you just want to get back to work. Mm. You don't want to be messing about. You just want someone to say, yeah, we're going to sort it for you. Yeah. Take the stress because you're going to be stressed. Take that away from you and just help you. That's what we need, help when it happens. Because it seems no one cares. Like a lot of guys won't even bother calling the police now. Because they just know the police don't care. Mm. And maybe they don't, not they don't care, but they can't do anything about it. They're not got the numbers. Busy, yeah. And there's no way of proving what happened at 4 a.m. when there was no one around and we've got no CCTV. And even if they get CCTV, a lot of the time they can't use it.
Mm.
I've had meetings.
They should always report it though. They always...
Because it helps the statistics.
Yeah.
But
it helps get it risen.
But some guys are so demoralised by it happening. And when it does happen, so... You know, you're at such a low point that there's some do just hold their hands up and think, fuck it, you know, I don't care
anymore. If it's happened on a regular basis and it happens for a third time, that might be enough for somebody just to be like, anyway, I'm going to stop the doom and gloom. I'm going to interrupt
fault.
No, well, it's a subject that we all talk about. Like you say, it's happened to the majority of tradesmen and women, but it's still something where, say you put the petition up, it's like pulling teeth trying to get people to actually go and back something which actually is in their best interest to. That's why we have different people on talking about products, whether it's tools, software, anything like you're doing, because I feel like people need to know that these things are out there to help equip or to arm themselves.
To arm them, yes.
So they're better equipped to deal with a situation that does happen or should it happen. You know, like prevention is better than cure in my mind, but... We're going to go over now because I feel like now is the time to stop that conversation and do the lap times.
Start your engine.
So this point in the show, we always do like it's almost like a Jerry Springer final thought. So any advice, or if you want to plug your socials, which you obviously probably don't really need to, but anything like that, or anything that you want to sort of like say to people, any advice, this is like the time to do it. So we'll start with you.
No pressure.
So no pressure. Like the best one was Adam Dunlop, actually, because he did the like a speech from the gods, wasn't it?
Pretty inspirational. Heartfelt,
yeah. You can do it. You can do what you need to do. Me and him were like, okay, all right, Barack Obama. So,
yeah, I would say that for anyone who's thinking about, well, if you're watching this, you're probably in the trades already, but if you're thinking about getting into the trades, it's a great thing to do. Like we're talking about going towards recession and stuff at the moment. People are freaking out a little bit. But I'd say if you're in a trade, you're always going to have work.
Yeah.
So that's like a great thing. And then if you want to go out on your own, like I said earlier, get some help. You know, get a mentor, get some advice from somebody who's done it before. There's so many people out here who are willing to help each other. Yeah. It's not a competition.
Mm.
So, you know, go out on socials, look for other people who are willing to help and get that support. And then, you know, you'll be more likely to succeed if you start on the right footing.
Yeah.
And plan with the end in mind.
Yeah.
And
so what is the end plan for Artisan Electrics?
Taking over the world one circuit at a time.
You know, I always ask people, and I'm very surprised. We had Damani from Diamondback Toolbelts, didn't they? And we said, what's the plan for Diamondback Toolbelts? Because they're one of the fastest growing companies in the US. And he went, world domination. And I was like, well, you know, sometimes I don't think there's anything less. I mean, you know, what would you like to see from the business or from the social side? Would you, you know, do you want 50 vans out? Do you want to become a bit of a Charlie Mullins of the electrical world? Is that something that you aspire to?
Yeah, I watched that Charlie Mullins interview and I found it really inspiring. And, you know, I look up to people like that. I think what he did is amazing, you know, and the brand that he created and the reputation that he created.
Yeah.
And ultimately what I just want to do is be able to do great electrical work for as many people as possible. And so, you know, and hopefully that means going, you know, UK wide and eventually going global.
World domination. Not?
Exactly.
Wow. I like it. It's good. It's good to have like people on that aspire to do more, because I think sometimes you can get knocked for being aspirational, I think sometimes on social. But actually it's good to hear, because I'm sure there's other people that are exactly the same as you that think, I want to be able to do that. So it's nice to hear that people have those aspirations. Now over to you then, Steve. What's your
aspirations?
Well, not yet. Well, maybe for the business, or have you got any advice or anything that you know you feel like we haven't touched on today, or any stuff that you want to discuss
in terms of advice? Yeah, download the app or register an account. It's free.
Yeah.
Start logging your tools. Start getting organised.
I'll just reiterate that for people. It's free.
It's free. In fact, we'll give you £5 to spend in store on tools. Just because we're early, we're trying to sort of build momentum.
Mm.
The other thing is, we do definitely need help with socials.
Yeah.
I need some tips from you guys. We're literally just starting out. So hit us up on socials. If you want a van sticker, we've got these. It doesn't work on a podcast, but we've got these van stickers.
Right, you can show them to the camera. And they're in a good colour. They're in a...
Sorry, I've just got a cough.
Yeah.
That's the trouble now, isn't it? Everyone coughs. Everyone's like, I'm going to wash my hands.
Do the stick a bit again, because then you can cut into
right
that
there.
And come out of it.
Hands, face, space, feet.
I've been waving my water at you for the last hour, so try and chuck me another one across.
Wow, you've drunk three, mate. I'm adding them to your tab.
Yes, so anyone can hit me up on the socials for this high-vis van sticker. Says this vehicle is armed. It helps us get the brand out there. If you then post it on socials, we'll send you a tool voucher just to kind of get the whole thing going, get the conversation going. And in terms of aspirations, we want to save people's jobs and careers, and want to build that story. That's one side. In the business, you know, we're going to keep innovating. We're there's lots and lots of plans and good ideas to make that tool logging quicker, to make insurance better, to make the hardware build it out. Yeah. So,
because I mean,
world domination.
Well, we've discussed it obviously before we came on that obviously you are really keen to sort of push the tool theft and, you know, potentially actually helping Pete with the help of the other people get this petition to actually the 100,000 that we need to get it debated in Parliament. So that I think that's like, you know, anything that you can help.
Yeah, we all need to get together. I think that would be amazing to get that.
And then if we can solve the other problem that if it does happen, you know, then I think that's really good from that side. So I'm really interested for the future for the brand and the product. Anything else you two want to add, or is that it done, or have you missed anything just in case?
Probably missed loads. Yeah, I'm gonna be cursing myself.
I could talk for hours.
Jordan's like, I'm here all day.
This is not my natural habitat.
No, I mean,
doing excellent.
I mean, from both me and Pete, like I love listening to people from the business side. So obviously, when I get somebody from a business, but when you talk about the business and your aspirations and stuff like that, so like, for me personally, like it's been like a real good episode to listen to you two talk and listen how, you know, you got into that situation and where you're at now. I think that's like really well done on your side.
Thanks for coming on, guys.
Thanks.
There we
Thanks
go.
For having us.
No worries.
Thank you.
Done. And then we take these off and it's like,
oh.
I prefer it with the headphones on. Yeah, I'd walk around with these on all day. Now it's like
going underwater when you take them off.
Your story actually, and I hate to bring him up again, Mr. Bundy.
No, but
it's very similar.
And I think that me and him are almost like subconsciously, we're like trying to make our dads proud by what we're doing, because he lost his dad. And
very,
stuff
very,
as well,
like when you know, said like, when you said that, because I wasn't expecting that.
Yeah.
Very, very similar. And it's just.
Yeah, it's like obviously an awful thing that happened, but it does change, kind of puts a fire in your belly as well somehow. Yeah. And like.
Yeah, it's a great. Yeah. Like, look, I love listening to, like, weirdly, everybody's story is completely different.
Yeah.
It's completely different. Mm. Yours is completely different because we haven't had a designer on. Do you know what I mean? So even talking about the product, but it's trying to tell people it's free. It's free. That's what I keep. Do you know what I mean?
And well, that's it. To be honest, nobody knows us. So that's the response we're getting is what's the catch? What are we doing? I mean, there's no other initiative out there.
Go on then, off you go. If you just took a pic, round, if you just took a picture of him holding his balls. Don't get any splashback on that Welsh flag, mate.
What brand are these mics?
Rode.
Oh, okay. They are
the right. Shores?
Shores, actually, yeah. Really, SM58s. Really nice, SM58Bs. 57Bs.
Yeah.
Bs.
Really nice.
I don't even touch the table once.
I think you did it once.
Did I?
Yeah, because I noticed
it,
because
Pete. Not make noise.
Yeah,
on my table,
you like this. But I find if
I,
you
I had my hands here, bit, I thought.
But yeah, it's like, for me, the reason I started doing this is I just love like the little bits like that. Because obviously I speak to so many people, but I don't actually know them.
Yeah. Mm.
So when I do stuff like this, I think it's great.
Yeah.
So well done on that. I can't wait to see you like signing autobiographies like Charlie Munger's.
Ah, no.
Be like, yes, look at that.
We'll have you back for a special one.
Yeah. But do you, I like one thing that I'll say about you, which other people come on, I feel they get embarrassed sometimes to say that that's what they want. Because I don't know whether it's like, especially with Charlie when we had him on, there were so many people that slagged him off in the comments.
Oh, really?
And it's almost like creating wealth now has got a stigma to it.
Yeah.
Or creating something of like... Yeah. Tangible, like
I just
that.
Think
like
if you're going to do something, you do it the best you can possibly do. And in business, that means creating a successful business that's going to grow.
I'm glad you said it, because like when I say it, I come across as a smug tosser. Do you know what I mean?
Like I probably do as well. I think you're right. Anyone who's trying to like succeed or create like a successful business does get hated on by people who sit on their butts their whole life.
I think
and don't do anything.
Some people want that, but then they don't. They either don't know how to do it, so it's not really their fault, but then they choose not to like ask those questions or do those things. Like I was never shown how to be a manager or run a business. Just had to learn it. Do you know what I mean? And there's days where I go home and all I want to do is just get the duvet.
Yeah.
Go like that and then wake up the next day. But people don't see that side of things.
No,
you probably get a few of them, don't you, when you start up?
Yeah, and I've come from running my own business for 20 years and on the design side where you constantly can hide behind nice work and just push that out there, and that might get criticism, good and bad.
Now you're the face of the brand, mate.
now I'm right at the front.
Shit, I've got to start a YouTube and Instagram and a TikTok. And
that's it. That's how we met, by the way. Okay. I watched a couple of Trade Legends and wrote to you on socials, and you basically said, how the fuck do you do this with Instagram?
Yeah.
I'm not like a pro at stuff, but you have to invest for, like, you'll say the same. Yeah. Social, like, I can't begin to tell you how many brands just do not get it.
Yeah.
And it's so surprising.
But he makes it look easy. Come on.
But that's
a few videos. Like, our cameraman always says, like, I don't know how you do it. You just black it all the time.
But even though you think it's only 4 years, if you're living and breathing it, 24 hours a day, you're probably wiring something, thinking, oh, actually, I've got a great shot for that. Or, like, actually, if we do this on the video shot, then get it from that angle.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
just overanalyze everything.
Yeah. And you, like,
Welsh dragon stepping up. Like in his women's top. He's going into the women's darts. Are you going to be one of them? He says, I'm competing.
Yeah.
How come when you stopped the business, did you kill the business completely rather than pause it and go and do your...
No, I sold it.
You sold it? Oh, okay.
Yeah. But it was enough to buy tools and get a van when I came back.
Right.
So, yeah.
I think part of that though, with you... Yeah. With it being a family business, is sometimes you just want a clean break from it and be able to
look at the grouping on them darts.
That is impressive.
I've just seen you put three in by yourself.
Yeah, so it was like, we had the opportunity to go and do this volunteer work, and it was like, amazingly, one of the guys who...
Oh, you're throwing darts. You're not exactly waving.
One of the subbies who used to work for me, he was like trying to grow and get more work, so I just sold the business.
Charles ready for a warm milk. Yeah.
And the volunteer work was electrics as well.
Yeah, construction. Yeah, so I was like site foreman, electrical for some kind of volunteer projects in South Africa, Croatia, the Netherlands.
Amazing.
Yeah, did a few years.
That's amazing. And then when you came back and set up again, how long was it when you were sort of on your own?
He's inspired now, he's like that.
Well, I had loads of questions, I just didn't want to interrupt.
No, just ask him.
I mean, on the show, but yeah. So that 2016, you came back, started just on your own, presumably?
I actually started, because we were in the Netherlands finishing up this volunteer project, and I was like, right, I need to start a new business. So I was online, like, buying a domain name, getting the brand set up and stuff. And then we came back to England for like a month, hired a van, scratched around, tried to get a bit of work. And then we moved to Portugal, and we lived in Portugal for a year. And I flew back like once a month, did a week's work, rented a van out of Stansted Airport.
Really?
get my tools in my mate's shed. And I did that for a year, just like back and forth.
Right, guys, sorry to shoot, but I'm going to go to the gym for a shoot.
Sorry to shoot, but I've got
really
to go.
Good to meet you.
Really good to meet
nice
you.
Nice to meet you,
yeah. We probably need to... go as well soon.
See you,
3 hour drive. So I did that, and then once the business had picked up enough to work more systematically, then I came back to the UK and like started properly in 2017.
Right.
And then 2018 became a limited company. 2019 things kind of blew up, and now we've got 15 employees. Social media, YouTube channel with 130,000 subscribers. So. Yeah, it's gone a bit nuts.
See, that's a bit I can't comprehend from where I am, which is effectively a standing start, social media. Also, it's not, you've got real knowledge to share, so you've got, in terms of content, it's always there, whereas I've got quite a complex story that I can only share in bits and pieces. Much better to interview, which is something I intend doing, tradespeople that have had a loss and experienced that, and just learn from it and generate content from that.
Yeah, that's good, I think, because that hits the emotions, and that's what you've got to do with content, really. It's like move people or provide value in some way that like genuinely helps people, so they'll share it out.
Yeah. I'll
That was the best part of the show, by the way.
which
that
bit?
That last 5 minutes.
Was it? Well, once those two fucked up.
The secret. Have you still been secretly recording that last bit?
Just
If you like listening to Al talk over all the guests,
no, just
if you've enjoyed this episode of Trade Legends, listening to Al talk over everybody else and people banging on the desk, if you've enjoyed listening to and watching today, you're fucking gonna just stay still one space just for a minute.
If you've enjoyed watching this, blah 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 blah. Okay, right, just, 3, 2, 1, go.
So I'll just not do it. Oh. Yeah, sure. I'm gonna shut up for just like a minute. If you've enjoyed listening and watching today's Trade Legends podcast, please subscribe to our channel. It'll really help us out. We're a new podcast. We want to do big things. And you subscribing, hitting the little bell so you get notifications, be just great. Thank you.
Hitting the little bell? I was like, ah, yeah, ding, 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 ding.
There is a little bell in there.